Hachette Audio presents Every Story Ever Told. Written by Ami Polonsky. Read by Cassie Holloway. Note to listeners, this audiobook contains references to a mass shooting event, which listeners may find disturbing. For my hometown, and all the hometowns. Chapter 2 of Every Story Ever Told depicts Stevie Jane's experience at the kickoff to summer when a mass shooting occurs. The chapter includes scenes of violence that are referenced throughout the audiobook. Chapter 1. Thursday afternoon to Thursday evening. According to the countdown clock scrolling backward on my laptop screen, 2,528 minutes stood between me and summer, which translated to exactly 6 more days of school, plus 2 minutes until the 3 o'clock bell today. 1. I closed my computer and slid it into my bag as Mrs. Engelman reminded us that our grammar final was on Monday. Of course she was giving us a grammar final. Leah tugged at my hair from the seat behind me and handed me her phone. It was open to her text chain with Zach Castle. "Will you be at the square tonight?" he'd asked, followed by a bunch of sunshine emojis and one red heart. "OMG," I mouthed, grinning excitedly. The bell rang and Leah squealed. "He definitely likes you," I said. "3 hours till he asks you out." The annual kickoff to summer was on the first Thursday of June each year. Mom had, of course, been on the planning committee again and had insisted that we arrive at the square not a minute past 6 o'clock. 3.5 hours, Leah reminded me. "I have to go to my brother's art show, remember? I'll be there at 6:30. "Oh, right. If I see him before you get there, want me to ask him what's up?" "Maybe?" Leah asked excitedly, in a way that for sure meant yes. "I'm so on it," I promised, giving her a quick hug as she squealed again. She zipped her backpack, and we headed for the classroom door. "So," Leah said as we crossed the hall, "unrelated to Zach, are you limping?" "Maybe just a tiny bit," I admitted. "You weren't limping earlier. What happened?" I sat down in front of my locker and unlaced one of my new Doc Martens. "If I show you, do you promise not to tell my mom?" "I won't tell your mom," Leah said, hand over her heart. I pulled off my right shoe and peeled down my sock. "Look." "Ew," Leah said, squinting at my foot and pretending to vomit. I poked at the blister. It was puffy and warm. "Why are we keeping this gnarly wound a secret from your mom?" she asked as I fished 2 Band-Aids out of my backpack. Before layering them over the blister, I took a close-up picture of my heel and texted it to Avi. "Because she told me this was going to happen," I explained. She was like, "Docs were cool when I was young, too." Then she told me all about her first pair and how she had to break them in, and she got the worst blisters from them, blah, blah, blah. Then she gave me Band-Aids. I shoved the wrappers into my jean shorts pocket as my phone buzzed. "You are disgusting. Our friendship is over. I hate you." I sent him a heart emoji. Avi and his parents, Julian and Laura, were our best family friends. They lived in Philly, but I'd get to see him in 3 weeks at the sleepaway camp we'd been going to together for years. Leah laughed at my fight with Mom. "Poor Stevie," she rubbed my head. "You have such a mean mom. I mean, how dare she give you Band-Aids?" I forced a smile and batted her hand away. It was hard to explain why so much of what Mom said annoyed me. "Anyway, I've got to go," Leah said. "I'll see you tonight. If you talk to Zach, be subtle, okay?" "Always," I promised her, wiggling my eyebrows. She blew me a kiss and disappeared down the crowded hall. I loaded my notebooks into my backpack. There was just enough room left next to them to shove in my helmet and wrist guards. Then I grabbed my skateboard, popped in my AirPods, and opened my text chain with Dad. Today's song of the day was Sweet Child of Mine by Guns N' Roses. He'd been on an 80s kick for weeks. When I hit play, a ridiculous electric guitar solo flooded my ears. Sweet. Outside, it smelled like summer. I dropped my skateboard onto the sidewalk and pushed off. Tree branches created a canopy overhead, and I skated through flickers of sunlight toward our street, shadows dancing across my shiny black docks and well-worn skateboard as Guns N' Roses vibrated in my ears. I sang along to the chorus, which I'd already memorized. Whoa, oh, oh, sweet child of mine. Nodding my head to the hard rock, I smiled. Whoa, oh, 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 sweet child of mine. It was almost 5:45, and I sat on my bedroom floor to layer several additional band-aids over each of my heels. Stevie, time to go, Dad yelled from downstairs as I pulled my socks back on and my phone began to buzz. It was Avi on FaceTime. I answered while lacing up my docks. Your ceiling looks amazing, he joked. Sorry, I'm in a rush, I said, still not looking at the phone. Iris Cohen is going to have a tantrum if we don't leave for the kickoff to summer right this second. Avi laughed as I quickly brushed my hair one more time before going downstairs. How could my heels still hurt? I probably had 12 band-aids on each foot. I'm so annoyed with my parents for not letting me visit, he said. For weeks, the plan had been for Avi to come to town today and stay for the weekend. At the last minute, his parents had decided they were too busy with work to drive him. Right? Me too. At the bottom of the stairs, I propped the phone on the entryway table so we could actually see each other. Hey, are you wearing, like, eye makeup stuff? He asked. On the phone screen, I could see Mom in the kitchen behind me, so I held a finger to my lips. But it was too late. She came over in her practical purple sneakers, her green fanny pack around her waist. Stevie, she said. I really have mixed feelings about this. Let me see you. I glared dramatically at Avi and then turned to her. Did you think she wasn't going to see you tonight? Avi asked, laughing. Hi, Iris. Hi, honey. Mom responded before turning her attention back to me. Truly, she went on, sighing, you look gorgeous, but maybe we can pick either the mascara or the crop top? Does it have to be both? When I was your age, I wasn't using up my mental energy rushing to grow up. It's emotionally unhealthy. It doesn't take any mental energy for me to care about how I look, I lied. Besides, I reminded her, you were my age in the 1900s. Mom scrunched her nose. That's not inaccurate, but it doesn't exactly sound right. Look, I get the concept of body positivity, but something about girls dressing as women doesn't sit well with me. My body, my choice, I told her, the familiar annoyance pulsing in my chest. If it were up to her, I'd be wearing a giant hot pink tent of a t-shirt right now. Just because that's the kind of thing that she wore when she was 13. I don't have the time to get into it, she said. We should have left already. Avi, say hi to your mom and dad and tell them we'll talk this weekend, okay? Okay, Avi said. Have fun kicking off summer, he added. We definitely will, Mom replied. Stevie, do you need any band-aids? She grabbed her water bottle off the entryway table as Dad joined us. Nope. I'm good. Your body, your choice, she mocked, and I rolled my eyes, blew Avi a kiss, and ended the call. Outside, a gentle breeze blew as we made our way down the front steps. Hey, Stevie, Dad said as I grabbed my skateboard from the lawn and Mom hurried us along. Something's funky. What do you mean? I asked. I think you lost half of your shirt. I tried not to smile. Somehow, Dad's opinion about my crop top didn't feel as judgy as Mom's did. "Nah, I'm good," I told him, skating down the driveway. "Where are your helmet and wrist guards?" they both shouted after me. "Come on, you guys are walking. I'm going to be going so slowly." Probably because we were already running late, they both gave in, and we turned down the street in the opposite direction of school. Two squirrels.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.